What up, podcast party people? How you doing? How are you? Greetings, my friends. Hanging out here. Man, tell you what, have I got an interview for you today? Holy shit. This is one intense motherfucker that I just talked to today. Fuck. John Joseph, Ironman, author, singer of the Cro-Mags, on their seminal 1986 album, Age of Quarrel. Oh my God, it was a crazy interview. It is one of the most intense interviews I've ever, it's one of the most intense conversations I've ever had in my life, let alone interview. That was really cool. All over the place. I mean, we went all over the place. It was awesome. It was awesome. What a life. This dude's lived. Talk about a real motherfucker from the streets. Wow. This dude's lived 10 people's life, 20 dudes' lives. It's crazy. You know, it's funny. When you grow up, and I grew up kind of a white trash neighborhood, you know, there was a lot of people. I remember one of my favorite songs when I was a kid, because it always reminded me of my neighborhood, was the song Bad Bad Leroy Brown. Baddest man in the whole damn town, by Jim Croce. And tell you what, man, let me play it for you. Actually, I won't play it for you. Probably not as good. It's not going to be as good if I play it for you. But maybe I can find it real quick. Maybe it's up on Spotify. Bad, bad Leroy. I do not see. Oh, there it is. Here we go. Right here. This shit right here. I think it's got a long intro, too. Are you going to play for me? You going to play for me, motherfucker? There we go. No. That's not it. Why is this not playing? Oh, yeah. Right here.
Let's call him, sir. That bad Leroy Brown. Baddest man in the whole damn town. Meaner than all King Kong.
That shit right there. I love this song. I'll tell you what, though. This song's about just the baddest motherfucker in town. And you better just watch out for him. And, you know, kind of growing up where I lived in San Lorenzo and then later on in Oakland, it's like, you can be a tough motherfucker, but I tell you what, there's always somebody who's a lot tougher than you. And you learn that shit real quick. And I tell you what, this dude's story is one of the most harrowing stories I've ever heard. I mean, it was very intense, and we shared a lot of commonality in our upbringing, and it was pretty heavy, man. Pretty heavy. I think we both cried a little bit during it, and it was awesome. And I don't know, for some reason, the whole time I was listening to his story, I had this song going through my head, because when I was a kid, this song always reminded me of, like, the baddest motherfucker in the neighborhood, and you better watch out for him. You know, and he was kind of telling all these crazy stories about all these fucking crazy people in his life. So, I don't know. That was just my brain kind of going all over the place after this awesome interview here. I want to tell you right now, this week's episode of No Fucking Regrets with Robb Flynn is brought to you by Perfect Bar, the original refrigerated protein bar. I'm going to show it to you right here. Right here. Look at this shit. Yeah. Show it on the screen. Dude, this shit is awesome. 20 plus superfoods, 17 grams of protein. It's got about 25 grams of carbs. Pretty high in fat. It's got like almost 20 grams of fat. But 27 carbs. I've been eating this way called 30-30-10. So 30 grams of protein, 30 grams of carbs, 10 grams of fat, 6 times a day. And this is pretty much a meal for me. It's a little shy on the protein, but I can get that from yogurt or some other stuff. But this dude, here, I'm going to turn off this music here real quick. This dude who makes it, I'm pretty sure it's vegan. Whatever it is, it comes in, this is a peanut butter flavor right here. They've got an almond bar flavor, and they also have a chocolate crisp. They're all about the same. They've all got superfoods in them. Dude, this shit is so good. It's really, really good. I back it. I back it hard. I eat one of these things almost every day. Very little processing, low glycemic, pretty much all natural. Tons of sprouted stuff and good stuff in there. So I recommend you guys all check out the Perfect Bar. They got a website on here somewhere. I think I've read this off before, but just Google Perfect Bar, the original refrigerated protein bar, and check that out. Right now, I'm going to play some of my favorite songs from the Cro-Mags. I love the Cro-Mags, man. This shit hit me like a ton of bricks when we were young. Right here, this is the opening track off of. Hey, hello. Whoa, there we go. I'm still playing some bad Leroy Brown, Jim Croce. There you go. This shit's heavy. So heavy. Mackie on the drums. Harley Flanagan on the bass. Paris Mayhew on the guitar. And Doug on guitar, I think. Mackie killing it. Drums are sick. Sick hi-hat lifts. Right here, though. Show You No Mercy. Every band jacked that riff. Every band jacked that riff. Alright, here we go. Sign of the time. Got a great line in it. You can totally hear the HR Bad Brains influence. This Machine Head covered this song back in the day. Hard Times. This show's sick. Gang vocal. I tell you what, this next song right here, probably my favorite song off of this record. Malfunction. Ugh, so fucking heavy. This goddamn song is so fucking heavy. Lyrics. Fucking good shit, man. That's the shit right there. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm going to take you on a journey with this man right here. This is the legend, John Joseph. You were talking about being a monk for two years. And you were celibate for 2 years.
Yeah.
So no sex.
No busting nuts. No jerking,
off?
Nah,
no jerking off.
Nah, man. Well, you know, you practice this kundalini, and you learn to utilize that energy, you know. And I trained in martial arts practically almost every day. I did my breath work and stuff like that too. So, you know, it was a test, but. You know, if you're going to do something, you don't keep, you know, 1 foot in and 1 foot out of the water. You know, you dive in, and that's what I do with everything. So, you know, whether it's Ironman or fucking being a monk or music, writing, you know, crack.
I mean, now that I hear that you were doing the martial arts the whole time, I was like, okay, because I was like, Jesus Christ, my rage button would be like on 11.
Oh, yeah. If I wasn't like breaking fucking shit up, I would be like, hey. You know?
Not jerking
especially
off.
Like,
did you jerk off like 13 times in one day the first day that you were out of the monkhood?
Well, it was pretty wild times. But, you know, I mean, at that age, look how old I was. That was 82. I was only 20 years old, young, dumb, full of cum. Wow. You know, but I have been through all.
So like 20 to 22?
Yeah, like almost, 2 years I spent there, like, and then I left and went back to the Cro-Mags and shit, and, you know, went from the temple to, like, living in a fucking burnt out squat, you know, so.
Holy shit.
You know, because I just, you know, it was just, it was something I needed to do at the time, you know, because. I had a lot of fucking inner demons from my youth and being locked up. I did 2 years upstate and you know, so it was just something that felt right at the time. And I was like, all right, I need to do this. Like Cro-Mags broke up. I stopped working with the Bad Brains. So it was just like, You know, and it was getting cold, and motherfuckers were like, yo, come to Hawaii. And I'm like, the state didn't raise no pool. Fuck it. So, they had a sailboat out there that used to sail around the islands. And I had, like, I was a bosun mate in the Navy. So I knew how to do maneuvering charts and rigging and shit like that. So I just worked on the boat out there first. And then I found out some of the Krishna monks was getting beat up. And then I was like, all right, let me utilize these skills I got. And I went down there and started fighting all the Hawaiians on Kalakaua Avenue. And they was like, who the fuck is this dude? And then I beat up some born-again Christian Marines, like spit in my boy's face and slapped him. I was just down there brawling. And I would take him to a parking garage and be like, all right, motherfucker, let's go. And it'd be like three Marines, and they're like, you know, yo, are you stupid? And apparently I wasn't. But, you know, it's all part of the journey, you know? So
take me back a little bit. Take me back a little bit in the time frame there. So Cro-Mags was together. This is before Age of Quarrels release, though.
Yeah, see, we started in 81 at 171A, and that's where I was living. When I went AWOL from the Navy in 1980 because – I'm writing
so like the film. 17, like 16, 17.
Yeah. Well, I went into the Navy. I was like, I was 17. I had just turned 17. And, what happened was I came out of lockup and, I caught another drug case and the cops, my mother was dating a recruiter. So she was like, we could get you in the Navy. Well, you're going to go back upstate. And I was literally out for like a month and caught a drug case.
Oh, shit.
So I said, hey, you know, all right, let's do it. And I went in with my brother E. And, you know, the day we went to boot camp, you ship out of Fort Hamilton in Brooklyn, right? I just came out of like Queens Central Booking. I was locked up, everything. And my brother E is a fucking maniac. He's like, yo, there's a dust spot four blocks from here. We went and bought five bags of dust. I'm not shitting you, Rob. We went to, I'd never even been on a plane before. This is my first time on a plane. And we flew to boot camp at Great Lakes high on angel dust.
No,
flipping the fuck out. Nice. And, you know,
on
I don't
a plane?
Know, yeah. If I don't know if people.
Yeah,
know
I mean me. That shit makes you feel like you're on fucking like yeah. You're a gorilla.
I was bugging the fuck out, dude. Like people were like, and this other dude we was with, he was handling it better. And the stewardess, they fly you on a regular, you know, plane, commercial plane. And dude was like, "Yo, it's his first time on a plane. Sorry, but you know." People don't really know this, but they used to bring you in. They always bring you into Great Lakes at night to disorient you. So you feel like you don't know where the fuck you are. It's out in the middle of nowhere. I'm on angel dust. I finally pass out in my rack and I wake up to like fucking M80s and garbage can lids going off. Fucking. I'm like, what the
fuck? Oh, shit.
Yeah.
This is your initiation.
Yeah, I went to after boot camp. I did well in boot camp too. I went to Norfolk, and I started smuggling on the ship. I had a drug business in Norfolk. I sold first time oh, I shit. Met the Bad Brains. I sold their manager acid. So I was selling pills. I was selling acid. I was selling weed.
Were you breaking the cardinal rule though? Were you getting high on your own
oh,
supply?
Oh hell, motherfucking yeah, I was. Hell yeah. See that back then, and if people research it, in 1980, the Navy and the military hadn't started drug testing yet. You could do any motherfucking drug. My brother was fucking high on acid, operating the nuclear power plant on a submarine. All right, so yeah, my brother's a fucking sick bastard, and you know he's like two of me, but he's got the fucking genius level IQ. So basically, when he took the ASVAB, the military entrance exam, they were like, yo, you qualify for the nuclear engineer field. Like, the world is your fucking oyster. Me, they're like, That's all amazing. Right, you can count cash at a ship store. I got the looks, he got the brains. So I sold to an undercover cop at this club in Norfolk. The two clubs was the Taj Mahal and the King's Head Inn. So I went to see 999 at the King's Head Inn. You know, Homicide and all those songs. Way back, punk rock band from England. And afterwards, this dude kind of, I never found out if he got popped and set me up or he just didn't know. But he arranged for a drug deal in the parking lot after, and I sold undercover cop pills. Mm. So I got busted. So then I was facing
speed pills.
No, like Tylenols, like Tylenol, like barbiturates, you know.
Okay.
And so the military, I had to go to captain's mass on my ship, and they were like, you're restricted, can't leave the ship. You got to muster with the master at arms, which is the ship's cop, every hour on the fantail. We're taking all your pay, just everything. And I had work detail all day, all fucking day. And they said that once the civilian court case comes through, there's a good chance if I'm found guilty that I'm going to be sent to Leavenworth, which is the penitentiary in like Kansas or something.
Yeah. Pretty heavy duty.
Yeah. They saying that's where the military dudes that have felonies and get caught, that's where they go. The UCMJ, Uniform Code of Military Justice. They was reading me the fucking riot act on the whole shit. So we go out to sea, and right before I had got my wisdom teeth pulled, so we go out to sea, there was this one redneck on my ship that kept fucking with me. Like, I'm like wearing Sex Pistols shirts. I'm the only punk rocker on the whole base in Norfolk, and this dude got to fuck with me. And I'm like, yo, I just did 2 years. I grew up on the streets of New York. I grew up getting my ass kicked. Like, you know, stop.
And he doesn't like you because you're a punk rocker?
No, he don't like it because I was from New York. He kept saying, you faggot, oh, right. New York, faggot motherfucker, like all this shit. And I was like, yo, just chill. And I didn't want to fight the motherfucker because, like, that's just, you know, whatever. And then we went out to sea. And I got this really bad infection. And I was in a lot of pain. And he just walked by me one day and fucking, like, kicked over my paint can. And, like, he was a big fucking dude. So he thought, whatever. And I just went into the paint locker. And they, you know, there's these latches in the Navy, and it's called dogging down the hatch. I went in and put two dogs on that hatch, and I picked up a paint can, and I beat that motherfucker until he shit himself and passed out. Like,
wow.
And then I went to my rack in the First Division Boatswain Quarters, and I'm just laying there, and I'm like, motherfuckers is coming. Sure enough, pulled open the curtain. Two master at arms, take me to the captain, restricted me, locked me down.
But you're out at sea though.
Yeah, we're out at sea.
Yeah.
So I got this soup. We had just left Roosevelt Roads. So like I'm having to see all these motherfuckers get off the ship in Bermuda and all these dope ass places and go on liberty. And it was fucked up. And they locked me down, but then I got this infection and my jaw was so bad. I had like 103, 104 fever. They're like, we can't treat him at sick bay. They had to medevac me off the ship back to Roosevelt Roads. And this is before computers. They forgot to put that, yo, this dude's supposed to be handcuffed to the fucking bed. So they put me on IV drip. 5-6 days later, my ship keeps going to Argentina, and they gave me my ID, and I was hanging out in Puerto Rico doing acid in the jungle, like crazy.
Oh, you got medevac to Puerto Rico?
Yeah, they sent me back to Roosevelt Roads to go to the hospital.
I didn't know where that was.
Yeah, right. Roosevelt Roads is in PR. That's the base. And I started hanging out with all these bug outs down there, like when I got out the hospital. And then they said, listen, we have to send you back to Norfolk to Nimitz Hall. So I go back to Norfolk, give me my ID. They're giving me paycheck, same shit.
Oh, shit.
So then they just don't know.
Yeah.
Yeah. After like 3 weeks, almost a month, the guy running was from New York. He was like the duty first class of the whole of like Nimitz Hall. Mm-hmm. And he was like, yo, your ship's coming in today. Wink, wink. They had got the fucking, they had sent them whatever the hell they did back then, like a message. And fax. I went and grabbed I think it was before faxes. This was like.
Does that mean you got to go back onto the ship?
No, that means I had to get the fuck out of it. I had to split. So I got on the bus that goes through the base and went out the main naval gate. And just as I'm doing that, the fucking master at arms is waiting at the light and crosses over in front of the fucking bus. And I rolled out the gate and I went up hung out in Norfolk for like 3 or 4 days. And then I went to DC. I was staying at Henry Rollins' apartment. He had a place. I think Ian Mackay was staying there. Henry was working.
Did you know them already?
Oh,
from
yeah,
the
I knew them because the yeah. thing was when I met okay. the Bad Brains. See, I was into the New York punk shit. I had this girlfriend when I was on the streets in the 70s, and she took me to all Max's and everything. I was in 77. I, you Kansas, know, 76. Max's, Kansas I heard City. Iggy Pop. Today's his birthday. Shouts to the godfather of punk rock.
And, yeah, shout out to Iggy Pop.
I got that album, man, Raw Power in fucking 76. I was like, before I went to St. John's Home for Boys, like the beginning of 76. But the thing was, so I was into punk.
So you were into the punk scene. Cro-Mags gets together, breaks up, you go to the Navy.
No. I'm telling you.
Am I wrong in the chronology here?
I'm telling you the timeline now. So what happened was the first time I ever saw the hardcore shit like that was 1980. I was into the punk rock, the pogoing shit. I'm at the Taj Mahal.
Yep.
The Teen Idols and the Untouchables come down to Norfolk and just took over the fucking show. Henry Rollins, all of them, shaved heads, fucking boots.
Oh, shit.
Creepy crawling. I'm like, what the fuck is this? Then the Bad Brains come like.
I mean, in Norfolk, that must have just been mind blowing.
Then I started going up. I had this talk with HR. I started going up to DC to all the shows and hanging out.
Okay.
So that's how I got to know them. And
because you roadied for them for a while, right?
Well, that's how I got to know the DC dudes. But then when I split, so Henry comes back. I'm at his apartment for like 2 weeks when I went AWOL. This was 1980. He goes, yo, man, you're eating all my food. You got to go, dude. You know, everybody's broke. He's like, yo, get the fuck out.
He's like, I'm going to work.
You're so I hitchhiked. The Undead, Bobby Steele was in the original Misfits. They played the 930 Club, and I went to see him, and I said, yo, can you guys give me a ride back to New York? I get out to New York, out of their van on Avenue A. I run in. First person I run into is fucking Harley, and he's walking over to 171A, and there's HR.
And this is how you meet?
Standing in the doorway. That was it. I moved in with the Bad Brains, and then all, and then the Cro-Mags started rehearsing at that point. But it was the Bad Brains manager, Dave Hahn, who was also in a band called The Mad back in the late 70s, this other punk band. So Dave Hahn was the drummer, Harley was bass, I was vocals, and Dave Stein, this guitar player dude, was the guitar player. We rehearsed for like 6 months, and then the shit broke up. Never played a show.
You didn't play shows?
No, we didn't play a show. Like, Harley wanted to do this shit called...
This is Cro-Mags, though.
This is Cro-Mags. Yep. That's the birth... If you read the original issues of The Big Takeover by Jack Rabbit, okay, it says Cro-Mags got together, and then in August, it says Cro-Mags broke up. after like 5 or 6 months of rehearsing at 171A. Dave Hahn gave his reason. You could look at that. I'm not going to talk shit, but yeah. So the shit disintegrated. And then I went on the road with the Bad Brains.
Was that the same songs though? Was it like
it was some of the song, stuff Malfunction? Harley's demo, like, because you know Harley had "Don't Tread on Me" and like a couple other joints that later became other songs. You know, when we put the album out. But he took me to the studio. He's like, "Yo, I'm working on my demo. Like, come and check it out. It's for my new band." And I was like, "Yo!" And
so he didn't ask you to be the singer. He just said, "Check it out."
Yeah. Well, he didn't ask me to be the singer. He said, "Check it out." And then, like,
had you sung in a band at that point?
No.
Oh, okay.
Nope. One time, HR threw me the mic at the 9:30 club, and I ripped off some verses and fucking dove in.
And that was your first. That was your first taste of being on stage.
Yeah, but you know, musically, like, there's a scene in my movie, and my mother told me, like, she was on the run. My dad tried to murder her. He was like a pro fighter, like just crazy motherfucker, dude. Like, just this Irish boxer, middleweight, not a good person. And we would always hide out. And then the only thing that we had was music. My mother would play 45s. And I would sing into the end of a fucking broom handle like I was a Motown singer. Right. It was always music. Even in the foster home, we were being abused. And it was the music that got me through it. So I always knew music was going to be like the feeling I got when I saw those punk bands in the 70s, man. Ramones at fucking CB's and the Dead Boys at Max and playing Max's and all this shit. I'm like, yo. Holy fucking shit. It was just, I was like, yo, this is my tribe. I didn't have family. This is who I'm supposed to be around, man. The energy.
What song do you remember singing into the broomstick the most? Like, what was your,
it was like Marvin Gaye and all the old, I don't remember what song it was.
Would you do the moves and stuff though?
Yeah. I would. And then, when we were in the foster home, they made us sleep in a garage. We were like 7 years old, 8 years old. And we had a little round, in the 70s, they had these little round globe TVs. I don't know if you remember those. They were they were a round ball, and it was a TV. So we found it in the garbage, and we put a fucking a metal hanger for an antenna. And we were sitting there on Saturdays watching Soul Train. And I would bust out all the fucking moves and just, you know, music was always.
Yeah.
And then in the 70s, I got, you know, I was in the boys' home, 76. I went to see Black Sabbath, AC/DC, Ted Nugent at the Garden.
Nice.
I got to see all of those fucking Rolling Stones.
Classic.
Like, just,
classic.
The Who. Concerts. Led Zeppelin. The original Led Zeppelin. Like,
oh, shit.
Just.
Like the Madison Square Garden.
Yeah, man. Yeah. Shows. And when I split from the boys' home,
Seen it in like Madison Square Garden? Is that where you're seeing it? Or is it like Fillmore East? Or?
Nah. Madison Square Garden. The Fillmore closed in 72.
Okay.
Fillmore was only open for like a couple of years. Like, I do that walking tour here in the city. We go to all those places, like CBGB's Theater, which is like, on 2nd Avenue, they had a club there. Hilly started a club there for like 1 year in 77. And the Talking Heads played, the Dead Boys, fucking Patti Smith, like just everybody played there. Wire.
That was like the original? That's the start of it.
Well, CBG
different from the one that kind of
in like 71. It used to be a biker bar called Hilly's on the Bowery. And it was that's how we got in with the Hell's Angels, because it was a biker bar. So all the HAs used to go in there, and it was Hilly's bar. And then when all like the rock clubs started closing, that's when Hilly opened up CBGB's to have bands play. Definitely. But yeah, just like seeing all those bands as a kid and being, I was buck wild. I was on the streets for 2 fucking years. And, you know, but anyway, then when I got to 171, when the band broke up, I had gotten in this fucking knife fight with this Puerto Rican gang called the Hitmen. And nobody stood up to them except for me. And I used to, like the DC kids, we wore a big bike chain, like with a quick release. That was our weapon. So dude tried to scam
like a
me.
Belt? Like a belt?
Yeah, like we used to wear chains, like a bike chain. Like
Right.
And then it had a quick release, and you just took that shit off, and it became a weapon. That's what, look at the old pictures of the DC punks. Yo, I had a metal shop on my ship. Somebody make me homemade spurs tied on with bandanas. You know what the spur was? I took a fucking razor sharp throwing star and had him put it on the fucking... Like this dude, Jay, they banned spurs at the 930 club because this crazy Jay motherfucker jumped off the stage and like almost took somebody's ear off. Yo, this shit was
with his boot. These are on the boots, right?
Yeah. With a spur. So it was violent back in the day, but everybody knew each other.
Oh my God.
We would beat each other down on the dance floor like a UFC fight, come out and hug, like, yeah, I lost the fucking tooth. Like, you know, it was a trip. But that Bad Brains tour down south, that was next level shit. Because Dave Hahn, our original drummer, sent out the promo posters and nobody knew. Everybody in Philly, Boston, New York, D.C. knew the Bad Brains were black. Soon as you got below D.C., nobody knew the Norfolk. Bad Brains were black. We played a club called the Big Bad
Boys. Is Rock for Life already out at this point?
It was the Raw cassette.
Okay.
The original. Yeah, so it was 81, bro. 80 fucking one. And the record just came out. I was at the studio when they recorded that fucking record, hanging out with HR, him reading me fucking lyrics. Like,
that's amazing. How did you become friends with them? I mean, did you just walk up and start talking to them? Like, oh, I love you guys. Like, I'm a fan.
With HR at the Taj Mahal, and then I went to see them in D.C.
This is the first time you met him?
Yeah. And it was just, I swear, man, I'm not like some cheesy motherfucker, but it was just like a vibe, man. It was something. It was a fucking vibe. And like this brother, I was like, I don't know what this motherfucker's into, but I got to find out, man. Cause I just came out of lockup, the streets, abusive foster homes, like the most crazy, insane shit. And this dude was like this mystical Rastafarian fucking madman. Like, I was like, what the fuck is this dude dealing with? And he said to me, we're going to see each other again, Rasta. And then when I walked up to 171 with Harley, he was standing in the doorway with a shit-eating grin and yells out, Rastafari! When he saw me. Dude, no bullshit. I'm like, and I just started hanging out. But after I got in that fight, because the Bad Brains were living in the studio and I had no place to stay, nobody stood up to the hitman except for me. Like, I was the one, and then they gave respect, even though I got stabbed in the shoulder. The Beastie Boys were there that night, everybody. They tried to, after I fought them in the street and I lost my chain and I tried to run in the studio, I had four motherfuckers trying to stab me. One of the Beastie Boys tried to lock me out of 171 studio. I'm like halfway in the door and halfway out. They're like trying to push me out. I'm like, yo, I just fucking fought for you motherfuckers because they had the drug spot on the corner, so they didn't want punk rockers hanging out rowdy.
Oh, gotcha. Okay.
It brought heat to the fucking spot. That's why the hitman fucked with them. They had the big drug spot on 11th Street between A and B. The biggest heroin cocaine spot in America.
Wow.
All right. And out of
Did the Hells Angels fuck with the punk rockers? Because out here in California, it was really like rivalry.
You know what? They was cool in New York, man. I have to say, I never had that experience. You know why? Because Hilly had an apartment in the HA's clubhouse on 3rd Street. Nobody really fucking knows that. And Hilly told them, hands off on the punks, I would think, because nah, man, the Hells Angels, if you were not the Hells Angels in New York, and you had everybody here, Chuck Zito, Bonji, the big old time motherfuckers that were they was cool. Bonzi used to take pictures of all the punk shows. But if you stepped out of line and did some stupid shit, like in Max's Kansas City, they did the security at all the clubs. And the old Max's, the bottom was a bar. And then after the original place, which opened in 69 from Andy Warhol, they got the second floor was where the bands played. So the staircase was on like almost a fucking, it was such a steep pitch. And if you got 86th out of fucking, if you got 86th out of Max's, they would fuck you up with hickory stick, ball peen hammers, and throw you down the fucking stairs. I'll tell you a story since it's Iggy Pop's birthday. That motherfucker was so crazy. He used to have the HAs put him in a 100-pound coffee bean sack, tie it up, and throw him from the fourth floor down the fucking stairs. On Raw Power where Iggy's chest is all ripped open, that shit was on the dance floor at Max's Kansas City that he did that.
Holy shit.
Yeah, so like,
he's a maniac. I don't know much about Iggy Pop. Like, I gotta revisit the Iggy Pop thing.
That was my fucking anthem. I'm the world's forgotten boy, the one who searches and destroys, because like, you know, I got basically abandoned. My mother became a depressed pill alcohol addict. So it was like, you know, I spent almost 7 years in a foster home. They never took one single photo of me and my brothers. We had to sleep in a garage. We had to fucking eat dog food, getting beat up and worse. So it was like that shit started resonating with me, the anger of the fucking punk rock shit. Then I heard that album Live at the Vortex in London and the Sex Pistols and all the shit that was coming out in 77. If you don't know that album, volume one, Live at the Vortex, holy fucking shit, man. And I just started, I dated this girl and I was like 15. She was like 18. And she took me, she knew everybody, took me to all the clubs. And then I would see the Ramones hanging out at 116 in Rockaway Beach. The year they put the song out, Rockaway Beach. And I would hitch. I would sell drugs in the city and then hitch.
Were you into the Ramones too?
I was living the shit. I was living it. That's, you know, going out to Rockaway, hanging out at the Circle on 116, selling drugs, going in the water, fucking just... You know, meanwhile, I split from the boys' home on 110. But they knew better. They could not come up to that boardwalk and touch me because I have protection. Hell's Angels used to hang out there. Everybody, man. Rockaway was the spot. Now you got all the little douchey hipsters fucking out there. But that shit in the 70s, that was gangster.
What was the best punk rock show from that era that you saw?
The one that stands out the most was the Ramones in April of 77 at CB's. And then I saw all the weird up and coming bands at Max's, man, like just fucking, I remember walking into Max.
Did you ever see Blondie?
Yeah. I saw Blondie in Central Park. I saw the Talking Heads in Central Park. Right? This was the hustle.
Have shows in Central Park?
Yeah, man. They have punk rock shows in Central Park. The Cars. I saw Debbie Harry. So we used to buy the Miller Nips, right? And we would buy fucking cases of them at the distributor, put them in a black...
What's that?
Miller Nips, the little bottles.
Oh, right.
I would sell beer at the concerts. It was the Schaefer series and then like all these other concerts. My hustle was to go up there and sell beer and in a plastic bag with ice. And I would make like $200-$300 and then go see the fucking show.
Like, nice.
I was living every kid's fucking dream. Fucking nobody maniac. Telling me what to do. But you know, that shit don't last. I got into some dark shit with, you know, my girl, that girl died of a heroin overdose. And then it just started getting crazy. These dudes I used to rob garages with on 116, you know, these guys, Junior Nuts and Dougie Holston, we would go to Bell Harbor and break into the garages at night, 2-3 in the morning, steal lawnmowers, chainsaws, bicycles, and then take it to Brooklyn and fence it to this dude in Greenpoint named Pops, this old guy. And that's how we made a living. But then Junior Nuts was crazy. He was like the Polish version. You know, Greenpoint's Polish. He was like the Polish Sid Vicious. First time I seen him, he was on the
Oh, these are all punk rockers? These dudes are all punk rockers.
Yeah. No, he wasn't punk rock. He was just crazy.
Oh, okay. It was just
crazy.
They turned
me on to Aerosmith, like the, not when Rocks came out and all that. But he was slicing himself with a fucking knife. Like, just, he ended up, like, just high as fuck on dust. And I had to split Rockaway because he stabbed this chick like 13 times in the face and the neck because,
oh my God,
he asked her for a light and she said, fuck off, because he had said some shit to her or whatever. They had some past and he just attacked her. So then they was looking for me. They was looking for them. And then I had to go into like Forest Park and then I started selling dust. I had already had two cases, one for selling to undercovers in Rockaway, and then another one, I tried to break into a supermarket rooftop, and the cops surrounded us. And so I was headed upstate, and I split St. John's, and then I caught the next case, which was dust.
Yeah.
And I was selling for the dude making the shit, named Computer in Forest Park. You know Frank Grillo, the actor? From The Purge, and like, he's a big actor now. Frank Grillo, G.R. His pops was alcoholic in fucking Forest Park. Frank Grillo gets my book and he starts asking, he's like, yo, dad, you know any of these guys? Junior Nuts, Dougie Holston, Bobby Bird, Computer, Disco Mike. He's like, yo, where did you hear those names from? He's like, my boy used to sell at the Dome in Forest Park. And his father said, I remember that kid, because I was the youngest kid out there. I was 15, holding all the bags of angel dust. And I got paid $1 on every bag. I was selling 300-400 bags of fucking dust, of Zambola.
Oh, so they were just fronting the dust.
They would give it to me to hold. I was the sales point. I was the point of sale.
And oh, right. You weren't selling it. Gotcha.
Disco Mike had a 45. He was the muscle. He looked like John Travolta on steroids. So we would sell at the Dome, and then we would sell at Grover Cleveland
Park. What's the Dome? The Dome's like a club or something?
It was a music amphitheater, actually, and they had bands play there. The Ramones played there.
Okay.
The Ramones
played
there.
This is in Central Park still?
Huh? It's still there.
This is in Central Park still? Okay.
No, this is in Forest Park in Queens.
Okay, gotcha.
So shit went south on that shit. We had sold this crazy motherfucker, Irish Tony's, his sister some dust, and she jumped out of the family's second story window and got fucked up. Oof. And then this dude came in blasting, and I got shot in the leg with a .22, and like it just heated up the park. And shortly after, some other shit happened. This guy, Disco Mike, he got murdered. He was taking kids to the house and slipping them Mickeys and raping them. So he tried to do it to me and this other kid. And I fought him off and I passed out. He put shit in my drinks. And then I heard screaming and I walked to the back of his apartment and he's raping the other kid. And I just picked up a fucking baseball bat he had, because all the Guidos had bats. And I just started fucking beating him bloody till he was just out. I took all his dust, his money, and I went to the Dome and I started just smoking on the benches. And that's when the cops came and got me. And then I went upstate to Spofford and all the other shit. Like, only white dude in Spofford. And I set the atmosphere for you. Roots was on TV. I'm the only white dude in Spofford. B3, check the history.
Wow.
B3, and then the radical group of the Nation of Islam called the 5 Percenters had just taken over all the shit. So you either was a Puerto Rican gangbanger or you was black, 5% of Muslim, and white man was the devil, and you had a fucking target on you from the moment you walked in Spofford. The Irish cops that took me there from Kew Gardens Central Booking said, the first motherfuckers that fuck with you in there, you better take them out, because the last white boy we took up there left in a body bag. That's how violent Spofford was. 21 and under,
shit.
No fucking joke. But you had 25-year-old motherfuckers in there lying because they didn't want to go to Rikers. But Spofford was crazier than Rikers, because you had motherfuckers all trying to make bones in there, get a name for themselves, all these fucking kids. The kids are way more wild than the fucking adults in Rikers. You don't want to catch a case. You want to go upstate, work your program, you know, do whatever. Spofford.
Get out. Yeah.
Young, dumb, full of cum. They don't give a fuck, dude. And I was fighting in there from the first fucking day I got in there, man. I had to put a chair over somebody's head. So, you know, it was a lot of shit to be having to deal with my whole life was violence.
And this is all before Age of Quarrel drops.
Yo, all of this set the stage. When you read them shit, Street Justice, Survival of the Streets, We Gotta Know, Malfunction, all that shit. That shit came out of the experiences of everything I've ever, since watching my mom get raped by my father. I was conceived out of a motherfucking rape from him. Like, I didn't even find out till later. Like, the shit that I've seen, the violence and the street, people getting murdered in front of me, having to fight for my fucking life, like, the real shit. Never snitching. I never fucking snitched. I could have got a drug program if I would have just turned evidence on that angel dust dealer. Right. I wrote a pilot for TV. You know who had me fly out to LA after he read the pilot on the angel dust trade in New York, and the cop that took it down, that fucking was involved with busting us, was fucking Howie Tannenbaum. That's Vince Gilligan's agent who did Breaking Bad. Had me come out to LA and sat down and like, you know, wanted me, you know, it's hard for a first time writer to sell a pilot, but he's like, bro, I get so many scripts. Let me tell you something. This is some of the realest fucking shit I've read. It's raw. The writing's great. I gave props to my writing teacher, Robert McKee. But like, you can't fake this shit. There's so many pseudo motherfuckers talking about I'm from the streets and writing songs and trying to act like they're this and that and shit that they're not. But the real motherfuckers don't ever have to fake the funk. The ones with the penitentiary pole, as we said, inside, they don't never have to talk shit. It's not the empty barrels make the most noise. I know you heard that one before. That's right. Not the motherfuckers that I'm keeping my eye on, the big mouths. It's the ones that don't never say shit. That's who you gotta watch. And that's how New York City was back in the day. You mind your fucking P's and Q's. You didn't mouth off and you didn't respect and disrespect people because you never knew who that motherfucker was.
Right.
And there was motherfuckers down here that would take your life in a second. So, you know, it's a lot of fantasy shit being talked out there. You know, I won't mention no names, but it's a lot of fantasy shit and taking credit for shit they didn't do as far as the Cro-Mags is concerned. And you could diss Paris all you want, but I'll tell you something right now. That dude sat there writing those fucking tunes, man, and he never gets the fucking credit. And I always credit him because he was the dude that sat down in his fucking house every night playing that BC Rich, writing that shit.
Yeah.
He was all about it, man. And me and him paid for that first demo even before Age of Quarrel. The Age of Quarrel black cassette. Me and him got the band in the studio to rehearse and take it serious and paid for the recording of that. His father had a country music label in Nashville, and his father pressed up the cassette tapes. So like, everybody's energy made that album, and I'm sick of motherfuckers trying to take credit for all this shit, saying I wrote all the lyrics and this, and I wrote all the music and all this other bullshit nonsense being talked. It was Mackie wrote the drum parts, Paris and Harley wrote the fucking music, and I wrote a majority of the lyrics on that fucking album. And without every single one of us...
Was Dougie in the band at that point? Was Dougie in the band at that point? Was Dougie in the band at that point?
Doug joined right before the recording of Age of Quarrel.
Okay.
He didn't write anything on that record. But it was all of our energies that made that shit come together and be what it was. Like, you can't take away from... You remove any one of that equation, and it ain't that record.
Oh, yeah.
It ain't that record.
For sure. I mean, there was a magic that you guys... Yeah. I mean, you. I mean, I was. I'm 52, so I'm 4 years younger than you. And
I'm,
I remember
I'm 58.
When
homie.
That when fucking.
I'm oh, 58.
You're, okay, I gotcha. When that shit dropped over, where I was a teenager, so I was like
Where'd
still
you grow
like
up?
15 or 16. I grew up. I grew up in Oakland. San Lorenzo
Kaiser Auditorium.
That's right, Jay Kaiser.
We played there with Motörhead. Right,
yeah. Yeah, I didn't catch you guys on that one. I know you guys played Ruthie's too.
Yeah, Ruthie's.
I got on restriction. I couldn't go to the Ruthie's show. I couldn't go to a bunch
you
of shows.
You look like you got on restrictions a few times.
we had a bootleg of you guys, and we had Age of Quarrel. Wow. But we had this live bootleg from you guys, and my friend was a tape trader. And when that shit hit, man, we were like, oh, my God. And we started seeing pictures, and you were like, these motherfuckers are maniacs. Like, what the fuck? Like, we were fucking completely fascinated. And we were into punk rock at that point. I was in the thrash metal scene. I was very much,
beautiful.
You know, we were really into,
oh,
all, I mean, that was like
the
golden era of thrash. Like, I'm seeing
level.
Exodus and, yeah, I'm Gary seeing Exodus
Metallica,
opening for Metallica. And they're opening for Raven to 250 people, you know, shit like that. And just, it's crazy.
We were into
punk rock. My second show was DRI on the Violent Pacification Tour.
Wow.
Where it was nothing but SF Skins at the Mabuhay Garden. And I was friends with these two punk rock girls. And they took us and we hung out in a squat with all these SF Skins and Dagger.
Did you have a Mark Dagger?
Yeah, Dagger.
Oh,
yeah.
He comes in and...
We went to that squat. We went to their squat, and we're sitting there, and we're, you know, I got hair. Like, we're wearing a flannel. We're just like, holy shit, this is fucking insane.
Yeah, man.
And we went in, and for whatever reason, because we were with these two girls that they were, you know, I forget what's the name when the girls, like, they like the skinhead. There's a name for it. I can't remember now. I'm brain farting on what the word is. Like a Betty? Is that what it is? When, like, your girl's like a...
I don't know.
Anyway, so they're like, leave these two dudes alone. They're, you know, we're just a bunch of little crummy 15-year-old kids. And they just, I just remember being terrified. And then DRI came on, who I fucking love DRI at this point. And just, they beat the shit out of each other for 45 minutes. Dudes were breaking beer bottles, jumping up on the stage, fucking opening up their foreheads, blood smearing it. Like, and I'm just like, oh, I mean, terrified and exhilarated all at the same fucking time, just like, holy fuck, like I need more. Some dude, I remember, they had a long haired like a metal dude, like really long hair, came in, denim vest, all this shit. He handed him the $5, and one of the skinhead dudes just walked up him and boom, dropped him. No long hairs. We were like, holy shit. We're like pulling up our flannels, like, fuck, like, it was crazy.
No,
and
I always
at that point,
like,
this is my second show. My first show's Exciter, the thrash metal band from Canada, Exciter. Second show is DRI, and at that point it was just, I was hooked. It was like, I've never felt an energy like this ever in my fucking life, and I need to be around this.
And you know, just, like, you know, even when we were playing out there in 84, like, we knew LA was like, all right, it was cool, but the Maniacs were up in the Bay Area. 100% Like, just Fang and all those dudes that were up there and like playing all those
early
shows.
I love that Fang
record,
man. Yeah, I love that Fang record.
You can never...
I invite you to my suicide. Yeah. I want you to be my bride. So fucking good.
We did some shows.
So I grew up a little bit in Oakland, grew up in San Lorenzo, and then by the time I was in high school, I was in like kind of just a normal suburb called Fremont, and we were taking our version of the subway up to all these shows.
Wow.
Berkeley, San Francisco, Oakland.
Yeah, man. Great times, bro. Fucking.
It was.
You know? And then when Metallica came out, I was a big fan of them. Like, I liked their shit, too. I started hearing, you know, when I heard Kill 'Em All, I was like, yo, these dudes are on some shit. Like, you could tell they were into the early punk and just took that shit to the metal. You know, they came out to see us after when Cliff died, and they had just gotten Jason. Like, James came to our show in 87 at Lemoore and got in the pit.
Nice.
During our fucking set. Everybody.
I remember hearing a story that Kirk Hammett played with you guys, or somebody played with the Cro-Mags in the band for, like, played during a show, and that they got spit on or something. That was a local legend. Maybe I'm confusing the band.
Crazy.
I mean, you must have seen some. I mean, like, that would have been you and Agnostic Front, at least to our, like, in my recollection out here coming from where that you were kind of like the two premier bands that were coming
AF,
out.
AF,
and I think that they might have been a little bit before. I'm not exactly sure on the chronology.
We started before them because we actually first started in 81. And then I guess I think they started coming around in 82, 83, whatever, playing at like A7. And it was like the first, like, it was like Rabies and John Watson. It was like not the best. They were trying, but the musicianship wasn't really there. And then they really got it together. And, you know, Victim in Pain and all that shit. I like those guys. I knew Vinny. He's a fucking character. Roger, you know,
Were you guys doing a lot of shows together?
Nah, we never fucking played together.
Really?
Oddly enough.
Ever?
Well, we had some beef back in the day.
Oh, really? Okay.
Like, people talk shit and then it's like, I'm not going to say whatever, but look, we had the crew that nobody fucked with. Nobody.
What was your crew?
We had guys that now are like special forces, high level government, fucking like protection people, like world class martial artists, crazy. We had this one dude down with us. He was a Royal Marine.
I always wondered if you guys rolled with a crew. I never heard, you know, no, like everybody had like, a crew back then. Everybody had a crew.
No, we had people that hung out. It wasn't a crew, like leather jackets with patches. They just were into the band, and we hung out, and they rolled with us and hang out. We lived in a burnt-out building, 713 East 9th between C and D. Like, everybody just hung out, but it was like, we had some psychopathic motherfuckers down with us. Like, we're just not crazy. They could fight like a motherfucker. I mean,
those are always good people to hang around.
That was the truth. That's the truth. I'm not just saying it, and I'm not just bragging about myself, whatever the fuck, but hands down, the toughest motherfuckers back then was the people that was hanging with the Cro-Mags. And I won't even mention them. We had this one fucking skinhead, black skinhead from Brixton, Errol, like, was a fucking black belt, split from the military over there, came over, just a fucking maniac, like, just insane, like, the shit. You know, you just didn't think about, we wasn't bullies, but we didn't let people fuck with us, man. So,
yeah.
But, you know, I don't know.
So back then, you never played with AF back then?
No.
Wow, that's crazy.
Never did a fucking show together.
Were you a couple of years apart? Like, was it partially because of that?
No, it was just like, I can't explain it. Like, I became friends. Yeah. I'm Roger.
Would you play a show with them now?
Well, we did. We played some festivals. Yeah. Like, you know, the lineup we got, which been existing despite the shit motherfuckers heard since 92, we started AJ on guitar, and then, you know, we had this other bass player, but then Craig started filling in, like, the last number of years, you know, since, like, whatever, you know, 2000-something. But, you know, we would be on some festivals together in England and Blackpool, that festival over there. But it was like, yep, never really played a club show together.
Right.
Weird.
Never toured together.
Never toured together. I would have loved to. Yeah. I would love to.
It's funny because, you know, Metallica and Slayer never toured together for 30 years because of their beef.
See, I don't have beef with these guys. They're all my friends. Madball. I would like to tour Madball, Cro-Mags, Sick of It All, and AF. And just storm the fucking country with that lineup.
They'd crush it.
Storm the country with that fucking lineup.
Who would headline?
Who cares? I don't. I'm not opening up, but I don't care if I don't. That show you don't want to headline because everybody's going to fucking injured by the time the last band goes on.
Yeah, you're gonna need some bands to open and some bands to follow, just,
you know,
so like you get the
care
sweet
about
spot in the
all
middle.
That ego shit. Like, we actually had motherfuckers not want to go on after us back. We had bands in that would be like, nah, they have to go on after us, like straight up headliners, because like Lemmy said this after we toured with him for fucking a year straight. He goes, the only fucking band I ever came out to watch every night, the only opening band on the fucking every single show was the Cro-Mags, because you never knew what those crazy motherfuckers were going to do. That's what Lemmy said in an
interview. That's awesome.
And it was like,
Did you do speed with Lemmy?
Huh? Nah. But I cooked. When we went on the tour, Lemmy had like 8 or 9 of his crew and like 1 or 2 Wurzel and whatever was vegetarian. So we was putting together our per diems, and then I would cook in the kitchen of these big ass places and cook for everybody. So I didn't do no speed with Lemmy or I didn't do drugs or drink.
Were you sober at that point?
I smoked weed.
Okay.
It wasn't until all the shit went down, the money getting stolen on the 87 European tour and me getting betrayed by my friend Harley, whatever, in the fucking band. And then I quit right before Best Wishes because of that. And then I spun out with this crazy motherfucker, Crazy Dave, this Cuban fucking family was drug dealers in Miami. And like, I just went down a dark place for 2 years, you know. But on the tours, I was, you know, I was clean on that shit. I was getting up and running 8-10 miles every fucking day on tour.
Oh shit.
Yeah, man.
That's awesome.
Like,
that's awesome.
Into the health, into the fitness. Like,
were you involved in the Best Wishes record?
Huh?
Were you involved in the Best Wishes record?
No, because what happened was we had already started playing those songs because it was like the album came out. The fucking Age of Quarrel. We was already
Age
playing.
Age of Quarrel came out.
Yeah, we was playing all them songs for years and started actually. There's tapes out there of me singing some of them songs on Best Wishes. Like, I wrote Crush the Demoniac, the lyrics, like.
Okay.
And then some of the other songs, it was different vocals. But, you know, we were set to record after the tour and we go to Europe and fucking your man Holly Flanagan there stole all the fucking tour money at the end of the tour. And I was like, I was already beefing with the manager because he was robbing us. I found a Winterland contract on his desk for Rock Hotel Records and he fucking forged our signatures. He was fucking like robbing us blind. He cross collateralized our publishing. Profile wanted to sign us because they had Motörhead. They was doing a rock division. So he goes, well, you could. He was managing us. He goes, you could have the Cro-Mags, but I want my own label on Profile called Rock Hotel, and they're going to be on Rock Hotel Records. Now, anyone
that's what
who knows
came out on, right?
Anyone who knows music business knows that that's a conflict of interest. How are you the manager and the record company dude too?
Right.
That's
right.
You're supposed to fight the label to get us paid. If you are the label, you're just taking all of our money, and that's what he did. And I was already.
Is it?
And he says to me, "I'm going to get you out of this band." And I go, "Motherfucker, you? What do you mean you're going to get me out of this band?" And I was like, "Yo, I'm the fucking singer." He goes, "You'll see." I said, "Let me tell you something, bro." He goes, "Listen, Mr. Navy, that was Chris Williamson saying if I put my hands on him, he knew I was AWOL. I was AWOL on MTV.
Oh, gotcha.
And going all over the motherfucking everywhere while I was AWOL. And then,
oh, you were still AWOL. Gotcha. During all that rise, during the whole
I'm
age
AWOL
of Coral.
Until 95
oh,
when Harley turned me in. Because I went back to the band. After we did all that, we reformed in 1991. Then it was the Alpha Omega shit. We go to Europe.
Yep.
He works out a fucking scam with Mark from MAD, which to take all the tour money and pay me $700 for like 38 fucking shows and say the tour lost money, this, that, the other thing. And then we get back to do the record, and it was just like being fucked up to everybody and saying he's taking all the publishing for cancer research and all this shit, and like just straight up and started to use fucking heroin. And then all the money disappeared out of the band's bank account. And that's when I was like, yo, fuck this. So Century Media, Robb goes, I had to get out of the contract. I had another band with Roadrunner. Roadrunner was going to sign us, but I had to get a release. So I go to fucking MA. I go to fucking Century Media, Robb. I go, yo, I need a release. He's like, we're not releasing you. We spent almost $200,000 on that fucking record. We need to like, you know, how about you do a European tour, a US tour? Because he said, Harley signed you as an individual artist. I'm like, what? Like, I thought we were signed as an entity, Cro-Mags. Right. No, he signed us as individual artists and then robs the band and takes off. And so I'm like trying to get out of the contract. So we finished. It became this shitty album, Near Death Experience, which was the unfinished tracks that those guys all wrote. I just sang on it. And we went and did a European tour and an American tour. I start getting phone calls in New York City in 95. If you don't stop playing all fucking whacked out on dope in San Francisco, if you don't stop playing as the Cro-Mags, I'm ratting you out for everything you ever did, AWOL, everything. I'm like, what? I was like, yo, bro, that would be the biggest mistake. It was Harley calling me. He came back. I seen him March 17th. He played some drums with Murphy's Law. The next day, fucking cops knocked my fucking apartment door down, and luckily I wasn't there. And that's how that whole shit. And then it took me a year to clean all that shit up, you know? But they was trying to put the Cro-Mags back together, him in Paris. So there was two versions of the Cro-Mags. So they devised this plan, which Harley was the instigator of it, because he was the one threatening me that he was going to do it. And then him and Paris went to the police and pressed false charges against me, knowing my, and gave him my real name, my fucking beeper, where I live, everything. Gave him a picture of me. And basically, you know, I ended up being friends with the cop, right? Officer, forget his name, Spanish guy, but Jonathan Shaw did his tattoos. The famous tattoo artist, and he showed me the police report.
Hold on a second. Yeah. My battery's about to die here, and I need to plug in the thing real quick. All right. Sorry about that, bro.
That's all right. Anyway,
I would imagine that it's. Is it? Have you ever listened to Best Wishes? I gotta say, that's one I love. The Best Wishes record.
Oh no, I like
the very first time that I ever saw the Cro-Mags was on.
Yeah.
Best Wishes. No. My old band Violence played with them on that tour. So
yeah. Like Age of Quarrel, that song on there, and like some of the other ones, like I played those. I liked the songs. The thing that I was kind of a little bit like, it was too much of, and I'm going to tell you because I was there, it was too much of a premeditated kind of like change of the sound. It could have been more organic if I would have sang on that record and had a say in what some of the other songs were that went on there, instead of being like a direct attempt to be metal. And that's what it was, because that's what the manager was saying at the time, like, you know, hardcore's cool, whatever, but you know, you need to write metal stuff. Metal's where it's at. I'm like, we're not a fucking metal band, dude. We have metal influences.
Consider yourselves a hardcore band?
Yeah, we was fucking hardcore punk.
Yeah.
Hell yeah. Yeah. And I think it's cool to have that. Like, when I was the one who turned Harley onto Geezer Butler's bass playing. Like, he was all Mr. fucking little punk rock kid. I was like, yo, listen to... He's like, fuck that. That's hippie shit and all this. I'm the one that turned him on to, like, Geezer's fucking bass playing. And that show, the first show Lemmy did at Irving, we were there. It's like, you know, I like...
Yeah, Motörhead was always the great connector, right? Like, you could... punks like Motörhead. Metal people like Motörhead. They were right.
Yeah.
Like,
hey,
what's your you've got to have some fucking amazing Lemmy stories, right?
Oh my god, dude! Amazing.
You toured with them for a year. You toured with Motörhead for a year.
Do you know how we got that fucking tour? Do you know how?
Because you were crazy and awesome.
No. Let me tell you something. Motörhead had us open for them at the Ritz. It was Motörhead, SOD, and Cro-Mags, right?
Oh, shit. SOD, wow.
Yeah, so listen to this. Lemmy and them was running around Alphabet City buying drugs and getting fucked up and doing whatever, hanging out with the HAs, just... So the fucking... Roadies did like this 5-hour sound check, just jamming and doing all this shit. And it started getting to the time when the doors were supposed to open. We didn't sound check. We didn't get out nothing, right? And SOD shit got set up in front of Motörhead. And then they're like, yo.
SOD was over you guys.
Yeah.
Go, cut. Because of Scott Ian. Yeah. Anthrax was probably pretty popular at that point.
Yeah, exactly. So we're supposed to go on, and they fucking bumped our set. And I'm hearing...
Oh, shit.
What Lemmy's...
Who bumped their set?
They bumped your set? Our set.
Motörhead?
Yeah.
Motörhead?
Yeah.
Oh, shit.
Well, the gig, the producer, whatever the fuck, the promoter, it got to be such a late... thing that they bumped our fucking set. And they go, you guys have to go on after Motörhead. I'm like, what the fuck do you mean? No, we ain't going on
after Motörhead. No, dude, fuck.
I swear to God. So fucking, I'm like, flip. Half the crowd was there for the fucking Cro-Mags. I'm telling you that right now. It was half metal and half punk rock, hardcore. It was our hometown. SOD's from New Jersey. They ain't from New York. You're in our town.
New band.
Yeah. And you could
didn't go
not
over
fuck.
Good. How did they go over?
SOD not, they didn't could go over good. Fuck with Cro-Mags. Come on. That's a joke. These motherfuckers in the Cro-Mags could play their goddamn instruments. So we get bumped. And then Lemmy fucking plays, and the lights come on, the gig's over. I go down to the motherfucking where by the headline. I said, "Fucking Lemmy, you motherfucker! I start calling him out. I said, get the fuck, fuck you, Lemmy. I'm a fucking fan since day one. You're a fucking asshole, motherfucker. Like, I don't take drugs. I don't drink. That's my natural reaction. Like, that's what I do.
That was sober John Joseph.
Yeah, that's sober. Saying that to crackhead Lemmy. John Joseph. Again. I would have ate his warts off of his face. But Lemmy comes out with fucking Hell's Angels.
Right.
And comes up to me. And I'm like, yo, fuck you, man. How the fuck could you do that to us in our home fucking town? And the HAs are like, you want us to fuck them up? Oh, I was shit. Ready to take the beating. I'm speaking my mind.
Oh, that's, I thought you right.
Lemmy goes, no. He fucking holds, he chills the HAs out. Right? And it was a bunch of them. I would have got hospitalized because they did the security at the Ritz too. It was the right. Security there with Mike Scapino and the whole, he was the guy who ran the club. Lemmy says, listen, man, I'm really fucking sorry. I swear we're going to make it up to you. You know, like a brother. And guess what? Lemmy stayed true to his motherfucking word. And when Orgasmatron came out, he fucking took us everywhere.
Wow. That's what an awesome record to tour behind, too.
Yep.
Like, that fucking record's killer.
And Megadeth, I think they lasted like 3 or 4 shows, and then Dave was on some crazy ego shit, and Lemmy was like, all right, oh, fuck off the tour, like, you know, whatever. I mean, Dave Mustaine will even tell you, I had a run-in with him at a Bad Brains show. They opened for Bad Brains, and I had to slam him off his head off the fucking wall because he was being a complete asshole coming into Bad Brains dressing room and picks up the black ice bucket thing where everybody puts the beers with all the melted water and throws it up in the air all over the Bad Brains and their kids and their wives. That was it. I snapped. Funny story. A few months later, you guys are opening up for Motörhead and Megadeth. I was Megadeth. Like, oh, shit. Like, he says to me before that, he was cursing in their dressing room because you in the Ritz, you had to walk through the Bad Brains dressing room, the headliner, to get to the back dressing room.
Oh, okay.
He was like, okay. I got to get my dick sucked all high on drugs. I was like, yo, dude, come on, man. Chill with that shit. There's kids here. Like, he's like, fuck you, man. Who the fuck are you? You're just a fucking roadie. He didn't know I was in the Cro-Mags. Like, and then when he threw that ice bucket, and I'm going to tell you something right now. HR is one of those dudes that doesn't come off with the big mouth, but it's a motherfucker you never want to get angry and be on the receiving end of that.
Oh, I watched him jump into the first time I saw Bad Brains. He jumped into the crowd at the Stone and just fucking laid into some dude. Just fucking fighting him. And like, I was like, holy, saw him 2 nights ago. I was like, holy shit.
With no problem.
Yeah.
A fucking
didn't give a fuck. And then jumped back on and kept on singing. That's
HR. So I grabbed Dave Mustaine by the hair when he did that. And I slammed his fucking head off the wall. And I was like, I said, HR, just give the fucking word, man. And the dude, Dave Mustaine, was like, yo, man. And HR gets in his face, I swear to my mother, word for word, verbatim, and says, you want to see violence? We will show you violence like you've never seen in your life. And HR was like, let him go. And I
cold.
Did. And then we get out. The first show was the Santa Monica Civic Center. And I was like, yo, I said to the dudes in the band, everybody, I was like, yo, what the fuck? I had this beef with him. They're like, just don't say nothing. See if he brings it up.
Right.
But we get to the Santa Monica Civic Center. We load in and all Megadeth's trap cases and shit are on, equipment cases are on the floor. Dave Mustaine sitting on the fucking thing. And he's got a huge bag of California weed. He's like, yo, Cro-Mags, you guys want to smoke some kind, bud? I'm like, fuck yeah. So we get over there, and he's like, yo, man, I love your fucking music, guys. You don't recognize me, right?
Like, you don't even know who you are.
Dude, you don't even know. He was so high that night. And then we're smoking spliffs of fucking chronic, right? And all sitting there hanging. And he's looking at me, and he goes, you look familiar. Do I know you from so much? I wrote about you in my book.
Nah.
I'm like, nah, dude. I never met you before. We're partying, talking some more, smoking. He's like, nah, man. I met you somewhere. I don't know where, but like, where did you grow up? He starts going through all this shit. And he won't let it go. Like, he just, every like few minutes, he's like, come on, man. Where did we meet? I go, Dave, I'm going to give you one fucking hint, and if you don't get it, I ain't telling you. He's like, I knew you. I go, you remember this? Who the fuck are you, man? You're just a fucking roadie. And he was like, you know, his eyes just, he's like, yo, I'm so sorry. Like, and we became, even on that tour, we became cool with each other. And he was like, yo, I was getting fucked up back then. Like, I really apologize. And that was the whole shit. Back then, you didn't hold grudges if somebody was like made a sincere attempt at an apology. Even when I fucked up, I had to go back and make amends to all the motherfuckers that I did grimy shit to when I was a drug addict for 2 years. Pay back debts, do apologize, do whatever. If somebody's willing to do that, then you got to make peace with that motherfucker. But if somebody just keeps constantly doing shit after you give them, you know, that's why my motherfuckers are like, why don't you guys do the Cro-Mag reunion again? I'm like, been there, done that 3 or 4 times, and every time I got robbed. So, you know, it's just like, if somebody really honestly apologizes and is sincere, that's another story. And I'll sit there and be right. Like, yo, man, like, the first time we got back together, I was like, told the beef is over, this, that, the other thing, but it wasn't, because it was over in my heart and my forgiveness and whatever. But, you know, it was just before.
I think it's pretty amazing that you have been through, you know, not just in the sense of the Cro-Mags, but yeah, in so many areas of your life that you have gotten to this positive place where you are forgiving. And, you know, you said something that made me laugh so fucking hard, because it was so goddamn true, on the Joe Rogan thing. And you talked about how I can start wars in my fucking head with somebody. And like, you, and I was like, I know what, like, I can have a fucking argument with somebody else in my head. And I'm like, what the fuck am I doing? Like, this is fucking crazy. Like, stop doing this. This is nuts.
Don't make assumptions. You know, it's one of the four agreements, yeah, by Don, yes, Miguel Ruiz.
And that's a great, that's an awesome book, man. I've read that book. It's an awesome book.
And dude, I'm guilty of it. Don't be impeccable with your word. Don't make assumptions. Yes. Always do your best. And yes, what's the other one? Old man moment. Be impeccable with, yeah, your word. Always do your best. Don't make assumptions. Don't take things personal.
Don't think.
I always took things personal. Yeah. I wrote that in my book, The PMA Effect, that just came out. I said I practiced the four disagreements.
Yeah.
I lied as a drug addict and to get what the fuck I wanted. I never did my best. I always took things personal, and I always made assumptions and had wars in my head, like a whole fucking thing that turned out, yeah, to, I still can do that sometimes, and I got to catch myself, yeah, and I'll be like,
I know it.
Maybe isn't what they're fucking thinking, and I'm just creating this whole false scenario. And like,
did you ever go to therapy or anything? I know you've done a lot. You've done a lot of soul searching. I know that. I mean, especially with, like, you know, the Hare Krishna and like a lot of the
and the training. That's why I got into Ironman, and I wrote The Evolution of a Cro-Magnon. Took me 5 years to write it. I stayed by myself. I didn't get it. Like, there was parts of that book, and I always tell the story where I would get to like what was done to me as a kid, and I would just break down sobbing for a fucking hour uncontrollably, because that was my therapy time after time after time after, yeah, time. And I would put
during the writing
for a fucking
during the writing of it,
writing the book, because I couldn't put that in there. And then I'd go back to it. And it was like, when you break a bone and it heals the wrong way and you got to like reset that fucking bone. I just had to keep resetting that bone like 5, 6, 7 times. And, but that was my, you know, my therapy was, you know, my yoga, meditation, training for Ironman, and writing that book and doing music too. Music's very healing.
Let me stop you for a second though. Cause I just wanted to say that I thought it was amazing that you put that in your book.
Yeah.
For one. I thought it was super courageous and super brave of you.
I'm going to tell you something.
I'm a fellow sexual abuse survivor as well. And I wrote a song about it back in 1999 called Five. And I pretty graphically detail what happened to me. And I didn't plan on doing that. I just had to do it in order to fucking survive. I was so self-destructive. I was fucking destroying myself. I had become fucking bulimic and, you know, I was older. So I kind of took it out. Like it used to be, you know, when I was younger, it was me just violent with the world. You know, it was me against the fucking world, fighting anybody, anywhere, any fucking time. And then at some point, like I got kind of famous and then I couldn't do stuff or lawsuits and I just turned it in on myself. You know, I turned it in on myself and I just became this unbelievably self-destructive, bulimic, on drugs, on fucking alcoholic. And and I started going to therapy at the request of my girlfriend, who's now my wife. And, you know, it just kind of helped me deal with it. And writing the song, you know, like I know what you're saying when you were trying to write that part in your book and you're like, you want to write it down. And it's like the same thing would happen. I would just fucking break down and I'd freak out and I couldn't fucking do it. And then I'd fall off the wagon and I'd go crazy again. You know, like I would just, it would kind of like, it would derail me. And, at some point I did. And, you know, I sang, I've never really talked about this, but I went and I sang the song naked. You know, like I knew I was going to come in and do it. I'd written the lyrics and I sang it naked. And when I sang it twice, I got through it twice. And that was all I could
fucking
do.
Unbelievable, man. Unbelievable.
And when I was done, I just laid on the ground. I just laid on the ground of, I was in a vocal booth and I just laid there for like a fucking hour and a half and just, you know, cleansed or let go of something, or, you know, I don't know what you want to call it. Like, I can't even really describe what I felt, but, you know, I just remember, and I wrote another song, right after I got climbed out of the studio or out of the vocal booth.
Wow.
It's called The Burning Red. And it was just about, you know, I attempted to commit suicide when I was 18 and I was kicked out of my house and I was fucking, you know, raising hell and just out of control. And on acid, I tried to commit suicide. And I wrote that all in this like 3-hour period after singing this song. And in so many ways, when I was done, I then was like, I don't want to put this out. Like, this is just too open. It's too raw. Like people are going to think I'm a pussy. Like fucking all this shit was going through my head. And I live with it for a minute, finally decided to do it. And that's why I commend you for saying what you said in your book. And, you know, you detail it pretty graphically that just, you know, how hard it is to just put it out there, you know, how much courage it takes to put it out there. And then after you do it, you realize how many fucking people have had this same
experience. I can't even tell you experience. How many people, famous people, like big, from famous to whoever, wrote me emails and were like, bro, I like, thank you for having the courage. It happened to me. Now here's the thing with the whole thing. I did the same thing, except I lashed out. I destroyed myself and I lashed out violently. Everybody always said, like, this dude, if you fought him, it was to the fucking death, because I didn't start fights with anybody, but I just felt like if you fucked and picked on me or whatever the fuck, it was, I just snapped. I lost it. But the thing was,
I mean, I felt like when I fought people back then, I was fighting the dude who molested me.
Yeah.
You know, like, that was fucking, it was decades of rage that came out.
Well, I got to tell you how it worked for me, because I was in a relationship at the time, and she was a writer, and we were working on a script, and we based the childhood of the character was based. I was giving her the stories of what the fuck happened to me, except I left out the molestation part. Me and my brothers don't never talk about that. So then we were working on the script, and we went to Robert McKee's seminar, and you were able to ask questions during the break of him. And if you saw Adaptation, which I just saw again the other night, Brian with Nicolas Cage, Brian Cox portrayed McKee. So I said, Mr. McKee, I said, as far as the protagonist that was abused as a child, and he stops me. He goes, stop right there. He goes, child abuse is the number one cliche of poor writing now to gain empathy and sympathy for flat characters that are one-sided that the audience could otherwise give two shits about. It's not what happens to somebody. It's what they do as a result of that. That is the story. And it floored me, man. It floored me. And I still hadn't told my demons. And then right after that, I had a dream. We used to sleep. They used to make us sleep in the garage on like army cots. And my dream, I was asleep under the blankets, naked. And the two guys, the older teenagers in the house that were molesting me, it was freezing in the garage, and just ripped the blanket off of me, and I was laying there naked.
This is
and
a dream.
I just woke up. It was a metaphor. And I woke up sobbing uncontrollably. And my girl at the time was sleeping with me. She's like, what, what? And then I just told her everything. And then when she knew that, and she went to Australia to be in a play in Sydney, because she was an actress, she put a note on this back wall back here, right where that Bad Brains poster is, she taped to the wall. You need to write your book. It's going to help a lot of people. Get that shit done. And I didn't know she left and went to Australia. And the next day I found the note. And I started writing the book. And every time I would get to that part, it's the embarrassment, you know. But you know what? Look what's going on now with all these child abuse cults and all this shit. If we don't say nothing, they win. We can't let them win. They did fucked up shit. They got to answer for it. We can't let them win and destroy us. And that's why when you suspect something's going on and there's shit, you fucking confront it, man. And you fucking ask what the fuck, what's going on here? You don't just, because that's the thing. Too many people turned a blind eye to what was happening to me. I posted the other day on Instagram, the first foster home we were in, we came to visit my mom. We were happy as hell.
Oh, I saw your, you had the two pictures, right?
The next picture, we were on a home visit from that foster home in Long Island, and they were doing all that shit to us. You could clearly see what the fuck was going on.
Very and my unhappy brother's kids.
A 25-year drug addict, my younger brother, because of it. So, like, I would never change anything that happened to me because it's what brought me to the path that I'm on. And if I add 1 + 1 = 3 in the beginning of a fucking, you know, trigonometry problem, the whole shit's wrong. So if you take, just like with the Cro-Mag record, if you take any musician out, it's not the same record. If you take any of those experiences out that you went through, you don't end up where you're sitting right now, Robb, and I don't end up where I'm sitting. So we can't let motherfuckers that do shit to kids get away with it. My teacher, my guru said, anyone who touches a child should be hung. That's how severe that is. What you're doing, And I'm going to tell you something right now, and I ain't said this nowhere. I told Joe Rogan, and he was like, yo, you think you could get the girls on the fucking podcast? Jeffrey Epstein snatched two of the girls that he brought to his island. Their mother used to come to this yoga center that I opened, and he used women to groom them at the ballet school where they went uptown, and they disappeared for 10 years. And the mother had a nervous breakdown. And what they would do was, when the kids aged out and they weren't younger kids, that all these pedophile motherfuckers could go down there. Bill Clinton went to the island 24 fucking times. All world dignitaries and politicians and famous actors and everybody was fucking going down there.
All those pictures of,
and raping,
pictures of the Clintons and him, pictures of the Trumps and him, the princes.
Dude, I'm telling you right now, that's why they killed that motherfucker. And now... Yeah.
And no guards were there, and the cameras went off, and fucking...
They're in fear for their life. They're in fear for their lives of what they know. There was a picture that came out.
The two girls?
There was a picture that came... Yeah, there's because they're older now. There was a picture that came out, and it was an older picture from, I don't know, maybe 15 years ago. Jeffrey Epstein was walking out of Prince Andrew's apartment, place, whatever, in London. It ended up on the cover of the Mirror.
Right.
The young girl that was with him was one of those girls.
Hmm.
So we can't let these son of a bitches get away with this shit. We have to fucking, you can, there's a lot of people, Rob, that ain't as strong as you and me and committed suicide and fucking their lives were ruined and addiction and OD'd and all of this shit, the PTSD that comes from that. They didn't end up as strong or whatever, and they didn't make it.
Yeah.
We can't let them get away with this. When you do shit to a kid, it stays with them their whole fucking life, man.
We can't let
these fucking scumbags get away with this shit. When they found, and I know people in the NYPD, bro, big people in the NYPD. I ain't no snitch, but they're friends in the fucking band. And through the vegan shit and whatever. You know what they told me? That when the cops saw Anthony Weiner's fucking laptop that they got, they broke down fucking crying. And some of them fucking threw up from the pictures of shit that was on there of what they were doing to kids. And you know who his motherfucking wife was? Hillary Clinton's fucking assistant. Yeah. They were going down to that fucking island, man.
He was the head of her campaign.
That's right.
Yeah.
Dude, all this shit is tied in. You want to keep thinking it's a fucking conspiracy theory, this, that, the other fucking thing. I'm going to tell you straight the fuck up, man. What these motherfuckers are doing to children and the pedophile rings that exist, yo, that's real shit. That's real shit, and that's really happening. The sex trafficking of children is a fucking reality, man. And we better fucking put a stop to it and bring these motherfuckers. And, you know, even when you know what I said? Because it even happened in the Hare Krishna movement. They were fucking raping the kids in the school. I went against every single
really?
One of them.
In the Hare Krishna movement?
That's right. That's right.
Wow.
Pedophiles infiltrated the movement at the schools and were raping and molesting the children. These are guys that are, this was back in the
80s. Is this outside of anything you knew about, or you're just hearing?
No, I found out. And then they became my friends when they grew up and told me all the horror stories, you know?
Hmm.
But it's like having that shit done to me and knowing what I went through, I ain't got no motherfucking patience for that. And we gotta fucking, if we know some shit or suspect some shit or see some shit is off, man, we gotta speak up on it, man. You can't let these motherfuckers get away with this shit. And this whole shit that went down with Epstein, man, they just swept that shit under the fucking, it got swept under the carpet. Look, nobody's even talking about it. It's just another thing that happened. And the sex trafficking of fucking minors and children, that's a fucking reality, man. And we gotta, you know, we gotta fucking help these kids, man. And, you know, but the thing is some very powerful people that are doing that shit. And they have every intention to make sure that those who are going to speak up get silenced. And that's all I'm going to say on that. But
how
if
you,
I hear a motherfucker
when you
touch a kid,
was the go ahead.
It's a wrap for that person.
Yeah.
But the cops that saw that laptop and what the fuck was on there, you had seasoned fucking homicide detectives break down crying because of, imagine if that shit was done to your kid.
Yeah.
That's what I tell people.
No, I got two kids. So I can,
imagine if somebody did it to your fucking kid and somebody else told you.
Did you ever have kids?
Nah, but I raised my nephew because my brother was a drug addict. So I was his legal guardian.
Yeah. Yeah.
But if anybody touched him, if anybody touches a kid or anybody, and I find out about it, I'm like, that's going to be it for that motherfucker.
What was it that helped you, aside from writing the book, just kind of get out of your dark place?
The training. I took shelter of the training again, and the meditation. You know,
was it when you wrote the book? Were you sober? Or were you still in?
Yeah. 100% sober. Yep. I was having, and the guys from Madball and everything will tell you, I was throwing these DJ parties and making weed brownies and weed shakes and all this shit and getting. And then, like, when 9/11 or right before, when, like, 2000, I was like, all right, that's it. So I didn't do any hardcore drugs or anything like that, but I stopped, and I didn't smoke either. I just would do edibles.
Okay.
But in 2000, I stopped that, and I was like, I'm an addict. I can't fuck with nothing because I have to do, you know, I have to do shit till I'm on the floor with like five weed brownies, you know, it's not.
Right.
But yeah, I stayed sober. I wrote the book. I started really getting into the training a lot more. And the meditation, you know, getting my mind fixed. Because the mind, and I said it in the new book, The PMA Effect, I wrote, it could be your best friend or your worst enemy. And it's like, when those thoughts and those bad thoughts come up, you have to be able to control that with the intellect, with the intelligence. And say, hey, man, where's it going to get you to go down this path right now and get this anger and fucking, you know, there was ways to channel it. I channeled it in the music on stage. I channeled it with the writing. I channeled it with the training. I channeled it with, you know, doing meditation.
You do community work too, right? You do community work too, right? You do community work. You do community work too, right?
Absolutely, man. I'm big on that. It's paying it forward, man, and helping others. I opened the yoga center on St. Mark's and financed it for 10 years. That fed the homeless and gave free classes to everybody. And I was basically like the master at arms there. I paid for everything and I handed the keys to this Hare Krishna couple that are fighting to expose the truth in the movement, and they took care of it. But I was like, nobody's coming in here and violating. So the lady that got her kids snatched by Epstein.
Oh, right.
That's where they were coming in there. And she was like a little older than me, hippie lady, sold jewelry on the street, really nice jewelry that she made, sold it on the street in Soho. All of her money went into her daughters to put them in this prestigious ballet school, the two young girls. And you know, I did all the construction too and paid for it all. And I'm like, you know, my mother, I can't even tell you how many hundreds and thousands of dollars that I took all my money to. And you want to see something? Nobody's seen this, because this is kept on my wall. I took every penny I had. And you're talking, see this money clip with this $2?
Yep. Yep.
There's a story behind that, and it's why it's on the wall. Because I took every penny I had from a record deal and all the other shit. I wasn't paying rent. We were in a law dispute. I was saving money for like years. And then we got the chance to do this yoga center and have the building. And it was like, I just kept doing the construction, paying everybody. It cost me like 40 grand, 50 grand just to get the key money to get in there. And then I had to do the construction in the whole building, because that was the deal. We're going to give you the space for this much money, but you have to renovate the rest of the building. It was the Little Missionary School, 93 St. Mark's, across from Jonathan Shaw's tattoo shop. And I had, by the end of it, I did all the construction, and then the last thing was to do the bathroom. And I had $7,000 out of like 100 grand left. And the plumber comes in and he says, we have to rip out everything to the joists. Everything has to come out. This plumbing contract's going to be, it's going to be about $18,000, $19,000. So I had to get somebody else in India to put up the remainder. And I put up the last I had. This was the last money I had on earth, but I never lost faith. This fucking $2 right here, which I've had since for 20 years, it's been in this paper clip, in this money clip on my wall. And I keep it as a reminder to have faith that when you help others and you do the right thing in life, never, that's what it says in Bhagavad Gita, the last verse, Ma Suchaha, never worry, right? And my mother used to say, because she knows what I went through. We're tight now. And she goes, when I first spent all the money, she wanted me to put money down on a house. I go, nah, Ma, I'm doing this. She's like, are you crazy? You need to have something. You don't have anything. You're getting older. You need to invest in property and have something to call your own and your own. She kept saying that. And I go, Ma, after it opened, I said, just come to the Sunday feast and see what we do for people. Come and see us feeding the homeless at Tompkins Square Park. Well, guess what? She came. And after that, with tears in her eyes, she goes, now I know why you did what you did. I said, Ma, this place is helping so many people. You have no idea. And people were coming up to her. I was so strung out on heroin and all this shit happened to me as a kid. And this place is like, this is like my sacred space that I come. And I get to do, you know, all this cleansing work in here and go feed the homeless and do all this other shit. And my mother was like in tears. My mother was in tears when she left. I even get choked up thinking about
it. I was going to say, yeah, you look like you're in.
Yeah, because my mother was like, you know, we went through a lot of shit.
Yeah.
And she always said, pay it forward.
That's amazing.
That's
amazing. That's amazing that you can have that. That's amazing that you could have that connection with your mom.
Yeah,
too.
Man.
You know, a lot of times when there's these, you know, addictive family, you know, I've got addicts in my family. My wife has, you know, my wife's father was a heroin addict, you know, mother was an alcoholic. And, you know, like sometimes you don't get that closure. You know,
how it happened? I was living the ending of that book. I wrote everything and then it came to, I said, how the fuck do you end this book? How do you end this book? How do you put a cap on this fucking book? What's the red, What's the five parts of story design, right? According to Robert McKee, you have the inciting incident, right? Us going into foster care, my mother, my father trying to fucking murder my mom. The inciting incident, progressive complications, the crisis, leading into the climax, and the resolution. I didn't know what the climax was or the resolution was. I had all these great stories, but that's not what McKee says is a great story well told. You can have a great story. You have to know how to tell it. And you know what happened? I got a call from this lady in Staten Island. She's right 2 days before 9/11. She says, if you don't come out and get your brother, he's going to be dead. He's living in my attic and he's near death. I went out September 10th, 2000, and I dragged him onto the from the Staten Island ferry back to my house. The next morning, the planes hit. He was supposed to go to St. Thomas to a drug rehab. He detoxed in my house. Oof. For a fucking 3 weeks.
Heroin?
Pills, coke, everything. Not heroin. Pills, coke, alcohol. Every demon came out of him crying inside, and I had to relive it. And seeing that, I had so much aggression toward my mother for abandoning us, and she chose this guy, Carl, over us, who didn't want us around. That's why we got left in the foster home. So my mother's husband robs her and gambled away the house and took liens, so that when my mother divorced this guy, George McShane, she was homeless. I took my money that I had, and I got her an apartment, and I furnished it and everything. So Frank goes down and finally got him to the rehab. He goes to Puerto Rico.
Frank's your brother?
Yeah.
Frank's your brother?
Okay. Frank's my brother. My mother calls me up. And I'm already fuming because, like, what I just saw my brother go through, and, like, you know. And she goes,
bringing up baggage.
I have to tell you something. I don't want you to get mad. I said, what? She goes, I have to tell you something. I let Carl move in with me. The guy that didn't want us around, and we had all the fucking fucked up shit happen to us. My mother let him move into the apartment that I got for her. Oof. And that just set me the fuck off. And I started saying shit to her. You never fucking cared about us. We were fucking trash. You threw us away. I said, and I blew up. I said, we were fucking raped in that fucking house. She's like, and then I just started going off on her. She never knew none of this stuff. And then she's like, I said, I fucking hate you. I fucking hate you. And this is on the phone. She goes, stop. You don't know the whole story. I said, I know the story that matters. Right? She goes, no, you don't know. Please. You know, she's begging me, crying. And then she breaks down and says, your father raped me. I left him. He broke in and raped me when your brother Eugene was a year old. That's when I had you. And he did it again 2 years later, and I had Frank. By the time I was 21, I had three kids with no way. The family told me to get abortions. I couldn't do it. He came the whole time I was pregnant. He was beating me up. He would come when you guys were kids, break in, steal all the money. I never knew her side of the story. I didn't find out till 2000. That I was conceived out of a fucking rape. Think about that. 38 motherfucking years.
Yeah.
After the fact.
That's heavy, man.
And I swear to God, dude, me and her sat there for 5 minutes sobbing on the fucking phone and not saying a word. We listened to each other cry.
Yeah, yeah.
And that was it. I was like, that's the ending of the book.
Wow.
That's why the book affected so many people.
Yeah. Man, that's some heavy shit, dude.
Yeah. But now me and her are real tight.
Yeah. And probably because of that.
Yeah.
Because you guys, you know, sometimes that's, I mean, that's what it takes. Not sometimes. That's what it takes.
I mean, she's literally like one of the strongest people I know.
Yeah. Yeah, she sounds like a... Yeah, that's heavy.
Fucking
she
was warrior. Probably putting...
Do you think... Did she say that it was putting you in the foster care to protect you from him?
No.
No?
She said, I chose somebody else over my kids, and I can never fucking take it back. I wish I could fucking suffer every minute, you guys. This is the climax of my film. Of my adaptation.
Yeah.
Because my book is about confronting the demons.
Yeah.
And the addiction. That's what I focused on. She said, I wish I could take back every second you guys had to suffer because of me. I chose somebody over my kids and I can never take it back. But I just want the chance to be a mother to you guys.
Yeah.
Steve.
How's your brother doing?
That ain't no bullshit. That ain't no bullshit fucking like sob story. Like that. That's real shit that people go through every day. Yeah. Verisimilitude, when you tell a story, it means it's like life. People can relate.
What did you say?
Verisimilitude.
Verisimilitude.
Yeah, it's a word. It means like life. Like people can identify with the stories that you tell. Because it's like, yo, they can relate. It's relatable, you know. It's shit that happens.
Yeah.
You know, but it's just been a beautiful journey since then, and all the great people I've met and done Rich Roll's podcast and fucking Joe and just Joe Rogan and just, you know, even here sitting down with bro.
You've had an amazing, I mean, it's funny because prior to talking to you, I have identified you as John Joseph of the Cro-Mags,
yeah.
You know, and I know you've written books and I know you've done know, the Ironmans and all that stuff. Having this conversation with you now.
Yeah. And I never
that's
knew
probably
you
the last part. That's probably the last part of it.
You know, like, I'm like, that's why the Cro-Mags shit in my book is like that much.
Yeah.
But I got
do you consider yourself like, are you an Ironman triathlete?
Like,
are
myself.
You right? I know. Like, you can't.
I'm just a motherfucker trying to survive, man. That's it. And right. Help as many people as I can along the way. That's not no Jesus complex. That is when I asked, how do I pay it back from my teachers? I was told you can't just pay it forward.
Yeah.
But like, even your story, knowing this, like, I met you, I don't know if you remember this, you guys played Irving Plaza a number of years ago.
Oh, yeah, yeah, totally.
And I came up and introduced myself to you, because I think you guys played Malfunction or whatever, live or something.
We covered Hard Times.
Hard Times, right.
Yeah.
But I introduced myself to you.
Yes.
And then, you know, Paris was hanging out, so I kind of shuffled off, you know. Like, I like, you know what it is, dude? I like Paris, whatever the fuck. I've wiped the slate clean. I don't have any hatred towards anybody. But I met you then. But now, knowing your story, like what you went through.
I'm sure you don't remember this, but we actually met in 91 when you guys did, when the Cro-Mags did the reunion at the Palladium in L.A., me and my friend
with
Biohazard
and the cops.
Yes,
the cops came because the bootleggers. We got into it with the bootleggers outside.
Yes,
and the show made it on the 11 o'clock news that night that a riot broke out at the Palladium.
Yeah, so my friends and I drove down because I had never seen you with the Cro-Mags, and I was like, oh my god, this is gonna be fucking. It was crazy about Biohazard. It was awesome. I mean, it was fucking, it was amazing. I mean, I was in the pit the entire night. You know, I'm long-haired, you know, dark hair, and, like, there was a lot of fucking Nazi skinheads, dude.
Yeah.
And then there was these black skinheads in the pit, and they were like, you need to be with us, motherfucker. Yeah. And I was like,
that's what's
okay. I was like, all right, I'll be with you guys.
See,
and we just fucking...
Like- I am,
but we got because Biohazard is on, and we were friends with Biohazard already. Yeah. We came back and we said hi to all you guys. We talked to Harley.
We talked to you for like a split second. We had dinner in L.A. like a whole bunch of us, and Evan was there. I talked to Danny. Billy's my boy. Bobby Hamble. Yeah. Like I always loved that those guys got the success that they fucking did because they went. A lot of people from the hardcore scene hated on them. I was like, yo,
yeah.
These guys fucking put the work in, man. You can't hate on that. Like, yeah,
Urban Discipline was awesome.
Fucking that unbelievable. Fucking Punishment?
I mean,
are you fucking kidding me?
That video was like, holy
shit. Coming over the Brooklyn Bridge?
Yeah. Like, that's what's going on over there? Holy fuck.
Yeah, it was fucking gnarly. Great, man. Fucking love those guys. I'm friends with all of those guys.
Yeah. So we met for a split second that night, and then I remember you coming to Irving, and we had already covered Hard Times, and
that's cool.
Yeah, and I had a friend who he was a big fan of you guys. I'm sure you remember him, but when Burn My Eyes first dropped, and we were doing press, we had already put out our cover of Hard Times on like the special edition or something, and so we met Ono Cro-Mag.
Oh, that's my dude.
Sure you remember. Yeah, Ono Cro-Mag. Yes.
God rest his soul, man.
Exactly, man. Exactly. And he came up, man, and that, you know, he was an intense motherfucker, like skinhead, head to toe. This was 94.
But was it in Europe?
This was in Europe, yeah. I was over there on a press tour.
He was from
Holland. Yeah, he's from Holland.
Yeah.
Yes. And so I come up and he's like, hey, I'm Ono Cro-Mag. You know, I think your Cro-Mag cover is great. And then just proceeds to tell me, you know, his crazy life. He used to be
a Nazi,
used to be a Nazi skinhead. Like, you know, he fucking got reformed at one point, but he still kept the swastikas to remind him of his fucking sins. And like, just, it was a very intense, like, but deep connection that I felt with this dude after talking to him. And we famously, we played the Dynamo Festival with Biohazard, and we covered Hard Times, and Bobby Hamball comes out, and Ono Cro-Mag comes out and actually sings the song with us and shit, and I'm wearing a Cro-Mag's windbreaker and fucking, so it's just like this weird, you know all these thoughts are going through my head, but I remember thinking, like, what an unbelievably, you know, to just fucking come out and introduce yourself and then instantly go into, hey, I just want to let you know I used to be a Nazi skinhead. I don't identify with that anymore. Yeah. And fucking, and then just have this super heavy conversation. We obviously had a mutual love of your music, and so we talked about that and connected on that right away. But it was, you know, so much of life is often this, you know, it's not as black and white as people want to make it. You know, like, this dude was a fucking, you know, admittedly, you know, on his own, by his own admission, was a piece of shit, you know?
Yeah, and you know what? When I make a post about Lemmy, like I did the other day, whatever the fuck, and they're like, that guy's wearing an Iron Cross. He said a lot of fucked up shit. He used to wear, you know, Nazi memorabilia. I'm like, I just block him. I'm like, shut the fuck up, dude. Lemmy hung out with everybody. Lemmy wasn't no fucking racist. Lemmy wasn't like, It was a different time. I had the Sex Pistols Destroy shirt that had the fucking swastika on it back in the day. It was punk rock. It was like, and I'm in the military. I'm walking onto the fucking base with bondage pants and the Sex Pistols shirt. And I'm like, fuck you. And they're like, the fucking Marines are like, who the fuck is this motherfucker? Like, spiked the hair and coming on to the base. Like, it was a different time, man.
It was a different, time for sure.
I mean, I said shit too. Like, some of the lyrics, Signs of the Times, I was like, I'm looking around me, don't like what I see, corruption and faggots all around me. And it was like, faggot in New York was not just a gay person. It meant like chumps. So to me, it was a double entendre, a double meaning, because I had motherfucking dudes do shit to me, and I had anger because of that. I never went and beat up gays or any of that shit. But I said that line, and everybody always, and somebody just posted the other day, oh, what's yeah,
if AIDS don't get you, then the warheads will. The
times. I said, you know what they are? Here's what they are. You know what I sing now when we do the song live? I'm looking around me, don't like what I see, corruption and problems all around me. I'm like, but when I wrote Signs of the Times and I was fucking, you know, in 1983, whatever, when I'm fucking 21 years old and trying to work out all this crazy shit in my head, you know, because I just did a documentary. It's going to be, it's a 5-part series. It's probably coming out on Netflix called 30.
Yes.
And it, I wanted to ask it was you about me, that. Paul DeGelder and me came up with it because it's what worked for me. And I went through the correctional facilities and it was the music and the yoga and the plant-based diet. And I took it to Paul DeGelder. And if anyone has seen Shark Week, he's the guy that the Special Forces, like Australian Navy SEAL that lost his arm and leg to the bull shark.
Oh, right. That's Paul. He's got like got the carbon arm or whatever.
He's a fucking beast. And me and him worked on it, and then we took it to Kip Anderson, who did What the Health and Cowspiracy. So that's coming out. But I made a post about something the other day, and some asshole goes, yeah, criminals, they're where they're supposed to be. They did crimes. And I go, listen, motherfucker, until you walked even a fucking block in that motherfucker's shoes, you should shut the fuck up.
Yeah.
You should shut up because you don't know what these people have been through.
Yeah.
Right.
I had a friend who he was my roommate's little brother, and he lived with us, and his family was homeless. You know, they kind of, you know, they'd live in roach motels, and then they'd live under a bridge for a while because the dad was a Vietnam vet, and you know, it was kind of crazy. It was just chaotic, just fucking chaotic life. He's 13 years old and like living on the streets, and you know, he was living on the streets. So like fucking when he fought people, like it was fucking to the death. Like it was
That's what you know.
And he beat them with he got jumped by four dudes, and he had a skateboard. He's alone. He had a skateboard. And he beat these motherfuckers. Holy shit. My car just filled up. What does it say? I got a little bit of time. I got 15 minutes left. Okay.
All right. We could tie it up.
Yeah. But he ended up beating these dudes with his skateboard so bad that he ended up winning the fight and like fuck these dudes up like fucking bad. And he had already been into juvenile hall a few times for other bullshit. Drugs, you know, small offenses, but just kind of it kept on escalating and piling up. And so they went to when he went to trial, they were like, you've got this history of violence. You ended up beating these people really bad. And he went to fucking San Quentin,
dude,
at 18 years old. You know, here he is. He's a blonde haired, blue eyed fucking kid. And, you know, thrown into this Manson's still in San Quentin at this point. You know, like it was fucked up, dude. We were all, I mean, we were fucking stunned.
Did Manson die yet?
Yeah. Yeah. But this is years ago when this happened.
Yeah.
And you know, he had in California, it was like, you're going to get with the white boys. You're going to get with the black dudes. You're going to get with the Mexicans. And that's it. That's the only way you're going to survive. Oh, yeah. This.
You ain't saying I'm not getting with my crew. It don't work like that.
Yeah. And when he came out, you know, dude had a fucking gigantic swastika on his back and a swastika on his arm. And, you know, here he was still, to me, he was that 13-year-old kid, you know, that used to live at my house for 5 years, you know, on and off. And, you know, I remember him looking at, you know, like they always have that term about people who come back from war, that the 1,000-yard stare.
Oh,
you know,
yeah.
Like I looked at this dude and fucking, dude, I'll never forget the look in his eyes as long as I live. Yeah, exactly.
Well, the guys
you know, like I, you know, he ended up moving around and kind of, you know, he went back into jail for a long time, and I would still let him call me, and he got out of it eventually, you know, like he kind of found his own path, but it was just fucking crazy and horrible. And, you know, like there's that again, going back to what I said earlier, like there's sometimes there's no black and white.
There's not
like that, you know, like this is a kid who used to sleep on my floor and who I loved, you know what I mean? Like dearly.
Yeah.
I was but, very you know, interested like, to hear what I wanted to, know what happened with your, like if it was coming out and if it was still on the table. Yeah.
It's being edited now and there's so much material. Like, I mean, these guys, let me tell you something, man, you want to talk about fucking stories of what these motherfuckers been through. There was no white boys. It was all Spanish and like grow up in the hardest motherfucking areas of LA. And
oh shit,
what do you do in LA when you grow up in the hood? You have to gang up. That's what it is. And they had no money. They were dirt poor. So shit went down. But these motherfuckers, you want to talk about hard time, doing hard time. One of the main dudes who I'm friends with, cause they all came to the Cro-Mags show when we played the Roxy. And oh, all shit. These guys, they didn't know, they never seen us play live. They were like, holy shit. And this one guy, Luis, I'm still friends with, and he does community service now. He's paying it forward. He stayed out of, all these guys had life-changing experiences, but he wanted to be a play guitar and all this shit. And I had a connection with a guitar company, and I got him a guitar. And like, but some of these dudes did like, they were shot callers inside. They got put in Pelican Bay. One of them did 2 years in the SHU. Like,
yeah.
When we met with them, it was, I would walk out of there every day and just fucking break down, man, and be like, lose my shit and be like, yo, these motherfuckers have been through some shit. They, many of them, when Paul took them to the ocean, they cried like little babies. They'd never been to the fucking ocean, and they live in L.A. Imagine that. Because they never went as a kid, and they just got out, and they did 20-something years, and now they're on fucking, they got to wear a monitor, bracelet, whatever the fuck. They're not allowed to go do anything. We got clearance from the state of California. Paul had them jumping out of airplanes, fucking
oh, shit.
Skydiving.
That's rad. Keith Mitchell, amazing.
Keith Mitchell, the fucking former Pro Bowl fucking cornerback from the fucking New Orleans Saints, was working with them. We had like top notch. Krishna Das came in and chanted with them. They did community service. We arranged a 5K run in Santa Monica, and the whole fucking town came out to cheer these guys. I mean, dude, there's moments in this shit. And I'm going to tell you one story. His name was John, and he was in his 70s. In the South, as a child, as a young man, his parents died. His uncle took custody of him. His uncle sold him into slavery, into the cotton fields. He was getting fucking molested by older people. He worked 365 days a fucking year in the cotton fields, and his uncle took all the money and beat him and all kinds of shit. When he was a teenager, 16 or 17.
Is this guy like older?
Yeah. He's in his mid 70s, like late 70s. Okay, right. Almost.
Yeah.
And dig it. Some white teenagers down South, older guys fucked with him, and he killed one of them, and he went to jail, and that started his fucking trip. He was in the motherfuckers, the shit that this man has seen in his life. Now, who are we to judge him for what he did? It's not black and white. It's not. And you have to take all things into consideration and be like, yo, dude, what would, like, that's how you write for characters. You say, you put yourself at the center of that character and you say, if I was that character in this situation, what would I do? Right?
Right.
Look what was done to him, and then somebody fucks with him and they start beating him up and he kills one of them.
Right.
Is he to blame? I'm sorry, but no. That's why I'm not down with the prison industrial complex. If you watch the 13th, the documentary, how they made slavery they added an amendment to the Constitution to make slavery legal in prisons. It's traded on Wall Street. It's all about
the privatizing of prisons. Fucking bullshit,
you know? Dude. And like,
it's a for profit system now.
Do you know that they came out and tried to remove, like, I just read some shit. They tried to remove a judge or something in this one area where the prisons are big because he was too lenient on sentencing and they had too many empty beds. Imagine that.
Yeah.
So let's look at the whole shit. And like, I did 2 years. I was locked up in some fucking bad motherfucking places. And a lot of those guys that went down, that's why when I go speak at high schools, and that's part of my service too. I speak at high schools. I speak at prisons. I go juvenile prisons, older people prisons, lockdowns. And it's because, yo, there's always hope. There's always something. And that's what you saw happen in these guys' lives. We started out with 13. And one of them got caught with fucking drugs in the middle of filming and had to go back to prison.
Oh, fuck.
So you're not cut. You see all of this shit. This is going to be a fucking life-changing documentary series for some people, man, to show. Yeah.
When's that coming?
I just talked to Kip last week and he got like the right editor now.
Awesome.
So I'm thinking I'm going to get to see something this summer, and then who knows when it'll come out. But, you know, he's in with Netflix and everything like that. Kip did an amazing job. All the people involved, like, just out of so much. Let me tell you something, man.
I'm the almost out of time on my thing, so I want to just point that.
We sat in a semicircle, and the hardcore motherfucker out of them all, this brother was Diesel. He had to get up and leave the room, and he broke down crying in the hallway. And he said, nobody has ever given a shit about me to give me an opportunity to change myself. They just locked me up like a fucking animal in prison. I can't believe you guys are coming here to do this. When he came back into the room, that's what he said. And I fucking was like, yo.
That's amazing.
Incredible, incredible, incredible documentary series of what we did and what they did for themselves. You could put the info out. If they don't apply it, it's of no use.
Right. Let me end with this, because I love where you're going with what you're saying here and how you're, you know, this whole path you're on to help people and rehabilitate, make people see a different thing in their life, make the world see in a different way. And, you know, a lot of what we're going through, and we didn't have time to get into the whole like pandemic, you know, New York's probably the hardest hit of anybody. And I'm sure life has completely changed down there
100%.
For what it is, but you know, in a lot of ways it's almost like a fucking giant reset button, you know. And in so many ways I've seen so many, you know, sure, there's been some things that are hard to deal with from quarantine, and life is going to permanently change. My wife's unemployed, I'm unemployed basically, and shit's going to have to change. But you know, like, in a lot of ways shit needed to change.
We've been barreling, right?
Right. You think about what you did,
and then you could come out.
That's right. Doesn't it seem like that in some ways, man? Like, dude, fucking.
And now you can either fucking be out there working on yourself and increasing. That's why my friend's a frog man, and he goes, if you don't get your shit done now, you didn't have a lack of time. You had a lack of discipline. So you could either work on yourself or go posting a million conspiracy theories, 5G and fucking all the rest of the shit that's out there. I'm not. I know there's corruption going on behind this shit, and I'm trying to make that known. But most of my shit is funny and like, yo, let's make some food and let's train and get your project done and this and that.
I'm with you on that. I'm with you on all that.
I got so much respect for you, man, sitting down and talking to you and knowing that we're both survivors, man, of of sexual abuse, man. It's and that's another thing. How many people come up to me and write me and tell me that shit? And I sit there and I answer every one of those messages. I had one guy tell me he had it sitting in his garage with a gun in his fucking lap. And I swear to my mother, he said, let me write John Joseph on Instagram. And I happened to be on Instagram and we went back and forth. And I sent them yoga books and healing books online, like how to read them for free. And he confided in me later and said, bro, I was ready to kill myself. And I didn't make a hole. I never threatened to kill myself to nobody. It wasn't about, you know, people that say they're going to do it, usually 90% don't. He was real. And you never know, man. We got to be there for each other and help each other. And enough of this fucking ego shit and I'm better than you and putting other people down. You know, there's an ancient Buddhist proverb, never cut off the head of someone else to make yourself taller. And that's what we got to really be doing too, man, is help each other through this whole fucking shit and be family and realize, like, it's us against the 1%. That's the real, fucking thing.
John Joseph, you're the man. You're a real ass motherfucker, man. Thank you so much for being on the podcast.
Listen, bro, I was so honored to sit down and you telling me, you know, your story. And then, I hope that this podcast helps anybody, you know, that's what it's all about, man. Much love to you, Robb. Hell yeah. Yes. I'll be at the next
machine. Ladies and gentlemen, fuck yeah. Legendary right there, Mr. John Joseph.